second thing is that we are very, very interested in building a software community in Columbus. If you run a meetup, we will host your event for free, or you can come to a place like this. We're happy to buy pizza or whatever we can do to make these communities successful in Columbus. And the third thing is we're hiring, so if you're looking for work, I can give you a card. So,
thanks, Ben. Let's get started. So as you know, this talk is going to be about functional programming and big data. So it's going to basically be broken into two parts. First, because I don't really know what everyone's level of experience with functional programming is, I'm going to give an introduction to functional programming, try to be brief with that, but go into enough detail in case people are interested in functional programming but aren't too familiar with it. And then I'm going to talk about functional programming and big data. So we're going to talk a little bit about how Spark came into existence, what Spark is and how you use it, and then how functional programming concepts are used directly in it and benefit you when you're using big data stuff. So, what you might be wondering is, who is this guy and how did he get in here? So, my name is Nicholas Tietz. I went to Kent State University for 4 years, got my degree in mathematics and computer science. Then I stayed in Kent for a few years working at a startup called GraphQL. We were also based in San Francisco, so I flew out there all the time. Then I moved down to Columbus, started working at CrossChecks. Was there for a little while doing data engineering stuff. But yeah, so GraphQL, we had a proprietary graph computing platform. So we were operating on pretty large graphs on pretty small machines, doing real-time graph algorithms. So less than 50 milliseconds to get friend recommendations for a new user in the system, which is pretty uncommon. Then CrossChecks was doing pretty standard data engineering stuff with Spark, getting all the data through, getting insights out of it, that kind of stuff. So right now, I am a consultant working on big data and scalability. So if you do want my card, give me money, let me know. I'm also working on a startup, which actually means that I am a man on a laptop. So I just took a screen cap of Google images there. Some of these look like me, some don't. So that's it. So let's get started on the whirlwind introduction to functional programming. We're all here because we have some interest in functional programming, right? Or we've heard that something we should care about. So show of hands, how many of you have actually used functional programming before? Okay. How many of you have used it for side projects in school or at home? How many of you have actually used it at work? I should have written down the other ones. Okay. Oh, and just to the side note, you see this little text at the bottom that you can't read. That's image attribution, because CryptoCon is a great foot source for that. You don't have to read that. So, looks like we have a pretty experienced audience. So, why should you learn functional programming? Well, when you learn functional programming, it's hard. It takes you back to the basics. Most of us have learned imperative programming, and that's all we've been taught. Functional programming basically resets things. You're learning from a blank slate. You have to learn programming from the beginning again. It's pretty difficult. Most people want a shortcut. There is no shortcut. So you're just going to have to suffer through it, and it's going to take possibly years to be productive in functional programming if you're just coming from an imperative programming. So why would you waste years doing that? It's going to be hard, it's not going to be fun at all times, and it's going to take you a long time to get going. Well, you would do it because you get a +2 attack bonus for flanking. So, good generals don't just attack their opponent at all. They consider all the possible options. They might flank them, in this case they're flanking the water, but they might flank their enemies. They might sneak up on them, they might attack them in the air. The point is that they have a lot of options at their disposal, they have a lot of different techniques. You should be like a good general and not just attack your problem from the front, not just attack with imperative programming. But if you learn functional programming, you learn imperative programming, you learn logical programming, you learn all these different paradigms, you're going to have a lot more tools at your disposal and a lot more ways to attack your problem. So at the end of the day, you're going to be able to solve your problems in different and more novel ways. And so even if you don't directly use functional programming, this is going to give you a different way of thinking about things. It's going to make you a better programmer. But I assume this is kind of old hat for all of you, because after all, you're at functional programming. who's going to be really awfully bored if I talk about this? Okay, good. Then I will talk about it. Wikipedia has a very dry definition of quantum programming. It says it's a programming paradigm that treats computation as the evaluation of mathematical functions and avoids changing state and mutable data. So if you get all that, you know you're probably not going to learn anything new. But so let's break it down for the mere mortals or whatever. So it's a programming paradigm. What that means is that it's basically a different style of programming. It gives you a different set of tools to play with. So the other paradigms you may have heard of are imperative, which is kind of just like you give the steps for your computation, logical, object-oriented, things like that. Despite the common perception, imperative programming and object-oriented programming are not intrinsically linked. So you can have object-oriented functional programming, or you can have imperative programming that's not object-oriented at all, such as in C. So a lot of these paradigms have overlap. There are a lot of languages that are taking idea of multiple paradigms. For example, Scala lets you do imperative if you so choose. You can do functional, which is encouraged. You can do object-oriented. So you kind of choose which paradigm you want to use for whatever. And programming paradigms really just give us shorthand for talking about languages. It's a way of classifying. So if you know you generally like functional programming, you can quickly make decisions about languages or quickly have an understanding when you start learning it and some basis to ground things. So then the next piece is computation by evaluating mathematical functions, which may be giving you nightmares right now because most of us did not like math at school. But it's going to be okay because this is a lot less scary than it sounds. So basically what it means is we just describe a precise relationship between the input to a function and the output from it. So a lot in imperative programming, you might feed something into a function, and then sometimes you get back A, sometimes you get back B. Whereas in a functional language, in most cases, what you want to do is you want to say, if I feed in A, I always get out B. And it's precisely defined, it's easy to understand. This gives you a lot of advantages as a human, but it also gives you a pile of advantages. Because if it's predictable, it's going to be able to optimize things in a lot more fast ways. And then the last thing is we try to avoid changing state in mutable data, which basically means in imperative languages, you can say x equals 1. And then later, a few lines later, you say x equals 2. And the compiler's like, OK, I got it. X is 2 now. But in a functional language, you say x equals 1. And then a few lines later, you say x equals 2. And the compiler's like, nope, you're a liar. You said x is 1. It's 1. And you can't change it. So once you set a value, it's that value forever. So that kind of shakes up the way a lot of people do things. What if a list grows? How do you add an element to it? Well, what you do, instead of just changing the list, is you actually create a new list that has another element in it. And as long as you're not doing things that are particularly unusual, the compiler actually usually figures out that you would have modified it, and it will avoid taking up too much memory. It won't actually create a new copy. So it can be pretty efficient to do it this way, even though it doesn't intuitively match how you do things in there. So the point is, like, generally we try to create copies of things that change instead of changing the things themselves. And that gives us a lot of benefits, which we'll discuss now. So we mentioned that we took out a few features when we went over functional programming. Because we took out the feature of being able to change data in place. Whether you think it's a good thing or not, that is a feature. And we also removed the ability to tell the computer which particular instructions to execute. Instead of saying basically like something that compiles down to move here, set this bit, we actually just tell the compiler what we want the data to look like, and then it figures out how to get to that. So how do we actually write code if we don't have two of the things we usually use to write our programs? Well, we actually get a few new building blocks to play. So functional programming gives us a few new things that we use principally to construct programs, which are higher order functions, lambda functions, lambda over there, and algebraic data types. So first, what is a higher order function? So in older languages, like older versions of C++ and older versions of Java, you actually could not pass around functions. You couldn't create new functions on the fly. So if you define a method, it would have to take in primitives or other objects, but it couldn't take in a function. were some ways around that. You could create anonymous classes that had overridden methods and things, but they were really hacks to get around that. Whereas in functional languages, functions can take in other functions and they can return functions. And so that's all higher order functions. And higher order function is one which can accept functions as a parameter or return them as a value. And it gives us a lot of really cool things that we can do. So fundamentally, the best thing we can do with this is write new control structures. So if you have an operation you're doing in, like, let's say, three different methods, in an imperative language, you might be able to refactor and get that out of there, but it's going to get shared code in one place, but it's going to be kind of convoluted. Whereas in a functional programming language, if you have something that looks like it's similar in multiple places, you can actually just make that an operation, and it can take in whatever functions you want to run and return things back. So basically define a new control structure, which is unheard of in most languages. This is pretty common with defining control structures and things like Lisp. It's what most people think of if you say define a control structure, but you really do it in any function. And so on that note, you also tend to not see like the stereotypical design patterns in functional programming languages. So who here is familiar with design patterns? So your singletons and all those things. The reason you don't really see the reason you do see design patterns in languages that are not functional is because you really can't pull out the core idea into code. Whereas in a functional language, if something is going to be used in a lot of places, and you might have some other custom code inside of it, you just pull it out to be its own function. And so you don't see design patterns in functional languages because if something is worthy of being a design pattern, then someone just writes a function that can do that. So it really simplifies things, and it really makes things, I think, a lot more useful. The other thing is lambda functions. Quite simply, a lambda function is just an anonymous function. It's a function which you're not given an explicit name. And it's mostly just valuable for being able to pass functions into other things. So like if you want to take a list and filter it down, instead of defining a function that has your predicate and then pass that function in, you can just write the function directly in the line when you do. And we'll see examples of those today. And then the last thing is algebraic data types. Again, kind of scary name, but really it just means you have one of two things. You have either what's called a product type or a sum type. The product type is things like records and tuples. So you're just putting together a few things and you'll have all of them. A sum type is just saying I'm going to have either A or B or C or however many things you have. It's basically just, if you're familiar with C, it's like a union saying I'm going to have any one of these things. So unless you express what would normally be expressed as an object or a class, as like just a data type. Haskell has them explicitly. Scala doesn't call them out, but really does have them. Most functional languages have them in some form or another, and knowing about them gives you a good way of defining things. So I'm not going to go into a lot of that on these. They're a good thing to learn about. I encourage all of you to read about them. If you want a good introduction to everything functional, learn Haskell. You won't use it in the real world, but you sure will learn a lot. So as we alluded to earlier, you can do functional programming in a lot of languages, not just in languages that are explicitly functional. JavaScript is not traditionally thought of as a functional programming language, but as Kyle's going to explain next month when you come back out to listen to him speak, so you don't have to hear me, hear him instead. You can do functional programming in basically, well, now almost any language you want, because a lot of these constructs are being added to what we're to do traditionally not functional programming languages. Java and C++ have lambdas now, so they have higher order functions. Python has had flavors of it for a long, long time. Maybe as long as it has been around, but I was not programming when it came out, so I don't know. And the JavaScript community is really getting behind this stuff, as you can see from React, Redux, and Rambda, and all those things. So learning about this is very valuable. And you can do it in any language, even ones that aren't explicitly labeled. So I can pretend that all of you understood that it all made perfect sense, but usually we have your programmers who learn by seeing. So I'm going to show you some code. So we're going to go through the Fibonacci sequence as a hello world example. don't understand stuff that's to be expected. So any questions before we move on? Okay, so Fibonacci. This is basically just kind of the old version of how the world. Everyone seems to have done Fibonacci sequence at some point. If you've done it like a traditional computer science education, I'm sure you have. If you learn online, you may have seen it. You may have done it, I'm not sure. But in case you don't remember what Fibonacci sequence is, this is how it's done. So you just have the zeroth element is zero, the first element is one, and then any element after that is defined as the sum of the two previous elements. So it's as far as mathematical definitions go, pretty simple. If we want to look at how it's defined imperatively, we end up with something like this. This is the cleanest imperative approach that I've written myself in Scala. I wrote on an airplane though, so if it doesn't make sense, I'm going to blame that. So basically what you do is you just say I'm going to compute up to n, then you store your first two elements as a and b, you store where you are, and you just iterate through shifting your two elements forward through the process until you get to the one you want, and then you return the final one. And we don't have a return keyword because this is Scala, everything returns a value, so the block just returns the last thing you send. That's kind of nice. We can walk through it, we can explain it, but it doesn't really look like the Fibonacci sequence, does it? So like, if I just showed you this code, take you some time to understand what we're doing if you haven't, if you didn't already know that this was Fibonacci. So wouldn't it be nice if we had an approach where we could just actually make it look like the definition of the Fibonacci sequence? Sure, we have it. It's called functional programming. So what we do is we just say which one we want to compute to, and we just say, okay, if it's zero, turn zero, and when we compute the first element, we use return one, and then for anything else, we need to compute it as the sum of the one of the two before. Cool. Very easy to write, very clean code. It's gonna run forever if you put anything remotely high in there, because this has a runtime complexity that's exponential in n, because you're gonna just keep ballooning the size of your computational tree, and you're gonna get stack overflows, you're gonna run out of RAM, you're gonna run out of time. So that's why I don't think that this is a good example, because the clean approach is bad. You should not do that. But it does show you what functional programming looks like. And it also shows you the problems of functional programming, which is that, so then you rewrite that something like this, where, like in the comparative version, you store basically like how many you have left to go, and you store your two elements that you're sliding over, and then you slide them as you iterate through, and you do that helper function, call the helper function so that people don't have to pass in the first two elements themselves, and then you get something pretty clean. I personally think it's very convoluted the first time you see it, but this is a pattern. I did say there aren't really patterns in functional programming, which is, this is a pattern. You'll see this a few times, where you find a helper function inside of a function, and then run that. It's fairly common. Once you see it, it's a little easier to get used to, but it's very jarring at first. This version actually compiles it, despite looking like you're going to have a stack overflow. This version does compile down to, in some cases, exactly the same as the imperative version. So what it does is, the compiler knows, okay, this is what's called a tail call recursive call. So the last thing you do in the function is recurse. So what it can do is it can just take the stack frame that you have and overwrite it with the next stack frame. So you know you're never going to need that stack frame anymore. So in a language like Scala, that's actually just going to get rolled into a loop, and you're just going to loop through it really quickly. And it's going to look a lot like this. It's going to run like the imperative. But there are two problems with that. One is that not every language actually has that. Python in particular does not have tail call recursion. This has been a point of contention in the community. The benevolent dictator for life in Python says he doesn't want it because it will make the stack traces worse. And then people say they want it because they can actually do things like this. So just be aware that while any functional language should support it, languages that aren't functional but have So it just ends up looking kind of convoluted. So is this approach better than the imperative approach? I don't know. It's up to the individual. I personally would probably write it as something not quite like this, but going in this direction. But it gives you the flavor, and if you know how to do this, it does give you a different way to think about it. So it's valuable to know how to do it, even if you're not going to actually write that. So I think that in the future, a good Hello World example is probably maybe something like Quicksort. Quicksort, you can actually write a pretty efficient functional version that looks like the definition of Quicksort and have it be about 5 lines, whereas it's much longer in comparative languages. The problem is that Quicksort's already pretty difficult to understand. So that's kind of the balancing act there. So now we all understand Fibonacci and we all know how to write functional code. So we're going to talk about lambdas. Is what the lambda does. So we're going to just kind of pretend now that we are a professor and we have a student roster that has our grades in it, and we want to do some things with it, like calculate grades or figure out who's passing the grade. So first we're just going to establish what our data type is. So we just define a class that has student that represents a student. We have three things: we have their name, their ID, and their grade. Okay? No discussion. So, again, comparative style first. Let's say you want to get all the failed students. What you do is you initialize your disappointments in the account team. Then you iterate through your entire roster. If anyone is below our observed and high standard, we put them in the disappointment bucket. And we return them at that. It's pretty clean. I'm sure all of us have written something similar to this at some point. This is pretty standard comparative. But there are two problems with it. One is that the second you also want to get passing students, you're going to have to write very similar code to filter the list in a different way. And it's going to be almost exactly the same, but there's going to just be basically this initial flip. And so you also have a maintenance nightmare, because once you start doing the same thing in multiple places, even if it's relatively short code like this, you have duplicated code, and if you happen to have a bug in it, which is more likely in more complicated real world examples, then you're going to have multiple places to go to fix it, multiple places to go to test. So, in contrast, in the functional version, there's already a filter function defined for sequences, and you actually just pass a function that's used to filter the list. So, in the imperative version, we check if the student grade is less than 90. In the functional version, we write the code that says, is the grade less than 90? And we just pass that in, and everything else is standard. So the advantage is, as you can see, we can also very quickly compute passing students without any duplicated code, which is kind of nice. If you happen to have a bug in your filter function, then you only have to fix it in one place. You only really have to test the filter function in one place. You don't have to test, actually, that this gets back to the students. You just have to test, okay, that this is the filter we want, and filter is going to be the passing step. And this is such an obviously better way of doing it than the other way that languages like C++ and Java support it. So functional programming is working this way into all our languages slowly. So the other thing we have in functional programming that you see all the time are maps and beats. I'm not talking about these kinds of maps, but this is very good. Watch out, there's a Google map of Columbus behind there. I'm not talking about hash maps, where you can get an element up. What I'm talking about is an operation that basically runs over the entire list. So what a map does is it takes the list and preserves the structure of it. So you're basically going to have everything there, but it's going to apply something to each individual element of the list. So what you could do, basically, is take a list of strings and turn it into a list of names. So every element is going to correspond to one previous element, but you don't have to iterate over it yourself, you just pass in the function to do the conversion. And fold, which is also sometimes called reduce, is kind of similar, but what it does is it actually operates on the structure instead of the elements. So it's a way of taking an existing structure and kind of like summarizing it or reducing it down and making something smaller. So you could output another list from a fold or reduce over a list, to condense it down, do something like a summarization. So with that in mind, let's pretend that now you want to compute average grades. So again, in the parity version, what you do is you take your roster, you take the total, you start your total at zero, you just go through and add each student grade to it, then you divide it by the length and through the total. The functional version, what we do is we first take a roster and we map a function over it. So what this does is it takes a list that previously had it was a list of students, and now after we apply this function, it's going to be a list of floats. Because this gets applied to each individual element and it changes it. And then we do what's called a poll. So this starts with the default value of 0, then takes that value and the next element of the list and combines them with this operation. So what we do is we just take the entire list of our floats and just add them all up, then we can divide by our length, which is the number of students. And we have the average. So does that make sense? Anyone have questions on maps and points? Yes?
So that example, the comparative example, would that run through n number of times and the functional run through 2n?
Yeah, that's true.
And it doesn't that some pages can have support to reduce, or is there any way around that?
So, I'm not sure how much the compiler is going to optimize that. It certainly is possible, but I am pretty sure that Scala is not. What you could do is you could actually combine more of your operations into one operation. So you could actually just remove the map entirely, do full flat, 0.0 is your initial, do A plus B, where it's A plus B dot grade. Because then A is a float, which is your accumulator, and B is the next element of the list, which is still a list of students. So you could do it in the same amount of time. But it's just going to be a little bit potentially less. And then it also would have shown you both the map and
property 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
Right? Yeah, where it preserves the structure or it doesn't.
Yeah, it wants to do something else, the same thing, you have to find these operations.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It'd be great to like mark that in memory for
memory. Yeah, I'm sure it was mentioned in my past. So, any other questions? Okay. So that was basically the low-hanging fruit of functional programming. There's a lot more that we could potentially discuss, and that we can definitely discuss in the future, such as monads, which we don't have time to go to. We don't have time to go to the functors, or anything like that, that the Haskell community would love to talk about. I would love to talk about. There's a ton left. It's really fruitful. It will shape the way you think. But we have to move on because we want to hear about big data. So I encourage people to go out. Yes, Steve.
I just had this might be more language specific. But you had a list of objects, kind of student objects. What if one of the elements is null that you're mapping?
Yeah, so in Scala that would typically just not be the case because you don't deal with nulls.
Okay, yeah.
We have the option type for that, so it can be a thing or none. I'm actually going to talk about that in a little bit, because having missing elements has really big implications for Spark, because if things like unexpectedly fail, so we're going to go through that, and just a little bit ahead of the curve. So yeah, we don't have time to go through everything, so we're going to move on, and we're going to talk about big data. So by hosting this talk, I made a claim that big data is, in some way, related to functional programming. So now I have to back up. So, first we need to go through a little bit of history. How do we get to where we are with big data? We haven't always had the infrastructure, we haven't always had the need for big data. Networks were too slow, this were too small, or we just didn't really have anything to carry to compute on. But then someone decided to index the entire internet. And the internet was sufficiently large at that point that we got really big data. You know who I'm talking about. They had a lot of really good engineers, they still do, and they were indexing the entire internet, so they got a lot of data, and indexing efficiently or doing computations efficiently, you have to do distributed. And if anyone cares about a distributed program, you know that it is one of the hardest things you will do in computer science. Because you have to now deal with race conditions, you have to deal with shared data access, you have to deal with shared distributed blocks, and all the things that are really, really difficult. It's a really rich research area, and generally, you don't want to have your engineers doing straight-up research, because you have no idea how long it's going to take them, and it's just going to slow them down, and it's going to make them less efficient. So, Google came up with this thing called MapReduce. So what it does is it takes in input data, and then, as you may have guessed from the name, it runs a map operation over the data. So it takes the data of one type, converts it to another type. Then it runs a distributed reduce operation over it, like we talked about before. Basically, it gives you a way to summarize data. They wrote a paper about this in the early 2000s, and so they never released their code, but they did write a paper on it. And they released a lot of papers on their core infrastructure, and that's really great. It really helps the community, because then fine engineers at places like Yahoo can take the MapReduce paper and implement it for all of us to use. So Doug Cunningham was an engineer at Yahoo, and he was working on the search indexing at Yahoo, and was running into some problems, and then Google released a paper on their distributed file system. He was like, that's really cool, that solved my problems. Used it, and that became what's now Hadoop file system. And then they released the MapReduce paper, and he was like, that's really cool too, I have that problem. And he implemented an open source version of MapReduce, which is known as Hadoop. And it's named after his kid's toy elephant. Fun trivia that will never win you any prizes. So in Hadoop, just like in MapReduce, you write a mapper and a reducer. It's just like your map and reduce functions, but instead of being nice and clean in a functional language, they're iffy Java classes, and because Java at the time it was written, did not have higher order functions. So why were map and reduce chosen as the abstractions for this? Because they could have picked any number of things. They could have picked trying to make an imperative style. Well, it allows us to express a lot of different problems. It turns out that almost everything can be computed with map and reducing. It's not always terribly efficient, but you can do it. So you'll get the job done, and usually your job will finish. Even if it's less efficient than it would have been some other way, it will finish before you would finish writing the imperative way, or the more efficient way. So if developer time is more expensive than server time, you can do it the slow way if the end-to-end time ends up being longer. Another thing that it does is it makes you think about things in a functional kind of way, which avoids side effects. Distributed computing gets a lot of benefits from avoiding side effects, because side effects are inherently involved in communication, and communication tends to be one of the bottlenecks in distributed computing. So if you don't explicitly have side effects, you can potentially cut down on network latency, let the framework manage a lot of that, and potentially get very big wins. It also makes it so that if a machine goes down and it had done partial computation, then you can easily just recompute that, because you know that's going to be purely based on the input that was provided. Whereas if you have side effects or randomness or anything, then you might get different results each time, and then you have potentially very large issues. Yes?
What's a side effect? Why is it bad?
We're going to explicitly talk about side effects later. But briefly, a side effect is basically just when you take a variable that you have or something in your university, you change it. So that could be updating a row in a database, it could be just changing a row, and just changing a variable, anything like that, anytime you're making a change. Another advantage of doing it with mapping and reducing is that it's a lot easier to test, because if you know that you have a fairly pure mapper and reducer, you can just test that those functions actually do what they're expected to on the provided input, provided expected output, and you don't have to usually set up like the entire testing in the reverse problem. You can test them in isolation, because so much is handled by the framework. But MapReduce isn't perfect. As I mentioned, some things are extremely inefficient in it. And there's some things you can hack into it, such as graph algorithms. You can definitely hack them into MapReduce. You definitely don't want to, because it's going to be ugly and you're going to hate your life. I know from personal experience. And there was also Java. Java was just kind of kludgy to write into maps and reduce them. So along came Spark. some very smart graduate students at Berkeley had an idea basically to write a new computing program. So runs on top of the resource manager that was pulled out of Hadoop. So Hadoop, when it grew up, had MapReduce, but then it also had to manage the resources for all the machines in the cluster. So at some point, they just cleanly separated those. So the resource manager is called YARN, yet another resource manager? Not sure. And then there's Hadoop MapReduce that runs on top of YARN. So Spark runs on top of YARN also. And you can use other cluster managers, but YARN is the one that was supported at first. So Spark is written in Scala, and lets you do basically all the normal functional programming constructs over your name. So you can do a map, full, reduce, filter, combine, all those things. You get first class functions because it's written in a proper functional language, and you don't have any kludgy Java classes where you have to pass in a function by overriding a function. And it's also faster because it's in memory. It's also less resilient because it's in memory. So if you run out of memory, your job ends. So being in Scala gives you a lot of advantages. Being in memory gives you advantages and drawbacks. So basically, what Spark is. Anyone have questions now before we dig in and answer? Cool. So what we're going to do is we're going to basically go through some examples in Spark that cover how you do a filter, a map, a reduce, and what's called flat. And these are going to kind of go in progression. They're going to motivate. Each one should hopefully motivate the next one. And then after that, we're almost done. We'll conclude with a 10,000-foot discussion of a few other things in functional programming that make big data just work a lot better. So the first thing we're going to do is a filter. I apologize if this is hard to read. It was easy to read on my screen. That's a consolation. So the first line here is doing a filter in Scala, just on a built-in Scala data type. The second one is doing a filter in Spark, and you'll notice that they look exactly the same. That's because they are exactly the same. So basically what this is showing you is just that the way you know how to do a filter in a functional language, if you do that same filter in Spark, you get performance gains of running on a distributed computing platform, but you don't have to write your code any differently, and it's going to work pretty well. This is probably kind of important. Why are you showing me this? Well, you don't want filtering to be complicated. Filtering is complicated, something's very wrong, and a lot should be refined. So it's good that this is easy because it was complicated to do to filter things, and now it's allowed to. So now we're going to do math. Once again, just like we did the maps in straight up Scala, what we do is we just take in a list of strings and we map over it into our integer converter. Exact same thing happens in Spark. You map over your list of strings and out comes a list of integers. So it's great if we have all of our numbers that our users had entered and we want to convert them to integers for some computation or summing them up, we want to see what the average number our users put in is. It's going to be pretty easy to write that code. But we do have a problem, because users, or just data in general, is messy, and sometimes what you think is going to be able to convert to an integer can't be converted to an integer. Because if I type in Bob, and then run Bob.2in, that's not going to convert, that's going to throw an exception, and we're going to have a bad dip, because if you get a couple failures in Spark, your job crashes, rightly so, because it can't actually do what you're asking it to do, and it decides to stop trying. So we have to have some way to handle that. So how normally in an imperative language you would just catch the exception that that's thrown. But if you don't really want to use the exceptions here because they're kind of complicated, kind of make the code convoluted, they're like using go-tos because you just jump to another spot in your code. So we can avoid that. We could return nulls and handle them later, but the problem with that is it breaks just a lot of assumptions because you kind of assume normally that it happens. If you're operating over data, it is there, and that's how we get into issues where you have null pointer exceptions. And it's messy. This isn't Java. We don't want to have to do null pointer checks everywhere. So the option we have left is actually what's called options. So in is you can basically say, I'm going to try to do this operation with a handy built-in try list. This actually does just basically it's a Scala code version of the try catch language construct, but you pass in whatever code you want to do. And then it will return something that converts an option. So an option is a data type that just has two values. So an option can either be sum of the value, or it can be none. And so this is an algebraic data type. You have these two options. And the advantage that we get with doing that is that if we go into the operation over this, the compiler's going to yell at us if we don't handle all the simulations. Your compiler won't yell at you if you don't do the null pointer check because it assumes that you know whether it can be null or not. But in this case, if you have an option, you explicitly have to handle all the scenarios. So it makes it a lot harder to write the code that's going to crash. You can still do it. It will let you, but it's harder. But we do have a problem here. So a map converts something from one data type to another. And so before we had we took a list of strings and converted them to a list of ints. Well, now this is a list of options of ints. And we can't just sum up a list of options of ints. So what are we going to do with that? We're going to steamroll it. We're going to flatten it. So what flattening does is it basically takes, if you have, well, I guess what you consider containing containers. It takes the things inside the inner containers and pulls them out into the outer container. So if you have a sequence of sequences, it takes all the elements of the inner sequences and just puts them together in the outer sequence. Or like you have with options, you have a sequence of options, pulls out any of the values that exist into the outer one, and leaves anything that didn't exist, just disappears. So it gives us a pretty clean way to get rid of those missing values. So we'd like to call flatten. Spark does not have flatten. So if Spark doesn't have flatten, how are we going to flatten? Well, Spark does have what's called flatten. So what it does is it just does a map over your data and then immediately does a flatten. So you can't actually do them separately. But that's okay. Because if you do want to do this separately, you can do this first way. You can just do your map as usual. End up with the list of options, and then just do a flat map of the identity function. So you're not changing the data, and it will be identical to doing a map and a flatten. But if you have an option, just do a flat map, and then it's just going to do it all in one step. It's going to be more efficient. And you're going to end up with a list of only the integers which could be converted from a string, and anything which is caused an error is just going to go away. So, cool. We have clean data now. So now what we're going to do is we're just going to compute the average of our student grades mean. Once again, this just looks exactly like what we had done before with Scala itself. So students is a distributed data set. We can call count on it to get the number of students. We can do the same math we had done before and the same reduce we had done before. This is just syntactic trigger in Scala to say, take the sum of the first argument and the second. You can write it the same way I did before, but this is just a little bit shorter. So basically, if you know function programming, you can write anything you want in Spark. It's pretty easy to do it in MapReduce also, but it's just going to be more painful in MapReduce. It's going to be more painful if you try to write something custom to distribute this across multiple machines. And so far, it doesn't seem like there is a good way to do this type of thing where design distributes it for imperative code. But it would be interesting to hear about it at some point. There's an OSU researcher actually working on that, trying to do a MapReduce like thing with imperative code, which is kind of interesting. So, who here has ever seen the word count example of Hadoop? Yeah, isn't it long and ugly? So the Hadoop's hello world is just taking a document, splitting it apart, and counting the words in it. So you just get back to the list of like, okay, hello was said three times, and hi was said twice. It takes pages of Java code, because there's a ton of boilerplate in there. And so if you do it in Spark, just split each line into all spaces and individual parts. You just do a map so that you have each word with a count of one, and then you reduce by key, which just takes all of the and if you have an argument of tuple, it doesn't take anything in the first element, gets and then applies the reduce to the sequence of everything that was in the second spot. So it provides a good way to do that improvement for you. Once again, it's a hack of sugar. That's just basically sending a sub-operation over. Okay, so any questions on Spark hands-on? Good, you're all Spark experts. Wonderful. So there's a lot more you can do in Spark. Like I said, anything you can do in a functional language, for the most part, you can do in Spark. So if you know functional programming, you're going to be really productive in it really quickly. There are a few exceptions, because there are some things that it doesn't let you do for efficiency, because there's just not a good way to distribute it. But generally, if you can do a functional programming, you can do it in Spark. Yes?
So Spark, full integration rate, is it in its own language, or is it also in Scala?
That's Scala.
Okay. So it supports that framework as like many different supports? Like it could be in Java, it could be in Scala?
Yeah, so it's Scala first. So Scala is always going to be the best supported in terms of like documentation is usually up to date for all of them, but it could lag in some of the languages. The two languages that they notably do support other than Scala are Java, which just kind of comes out of the box. They actually did build some extra stuff around it to make it a little bit cleaner, and then also Python. But Python is also going to be less efficient, so it's just a trade-off that people make between developer productivity. Yeah, so if you want to learn more about Spark, there's really great documentation out there. There are a lot of people out there in the community. Or just tell me what you want to hear about in the future meetup. We don't have time to go super depth on Spark in the API. There's a lot of good material out there. So now we're going to talk about two things high level that relate to both functional programming and big data. And those are associativity and commutativity. There we go in scary math terms. And side effects and IO operations. So associativity is this property that we have in math, which basically says that we can take a list of things that we're doing an operation on, like A plus B plus C, and we can group them however we want. So we have to have it be true that if A plus B plus C is equal to A plus B plus C for all possible values. So addition is commutative, means we have that property. Multiplication is commutative, means we have that property. Subtraction is not. Subtraction, you can't group it however you want. You have to go left to right. Same with division, same with exponentiation. You try to group it a different way, you're going to get different values, and it really changes the meaning. We'll get into why this matters in a second, but first let's remember what commutativity is. Commutativity is just the ability to change the order of the operations. Once again, addition and multiplication, they're commutative. You can swap them around, that's fine. Again, subtraction, division, exponentiation aren't. So why does this matter? Well, it matters because if you don't use these properties, you're going to get undefined values. So if you imagine basically you have a list of integers, and you do a distributed U, a reduce over it, and the operation you pick is A minus B, what is the result going to be? We don't actually know. It's going to just depend on the order that Spark decides to execute your code. If something has to be recomputed, it's potentially going to be a different value. So you might even crash Spark by doing this. So usually you would not try to reduce with subtraction or division or exponentiation because there are obvious alternatives and that's obviously a bad idea. So the point is not to avoid those with no operations. That you start getting things changing in strange ways, not being consistent run to run in your smart jobs, or then you might want to think about these properties. Or if you're having crashes and you can't explain, you might want to think about these properties. Because when you have complicated code, sometimes somewhere along the line you might actually accidentally lose associativity and commutativity. And so it can sometimes manifest in a kind of subtle way. And you'll want to go back and look for those when you're emailing. Having them around helps Spark optimize things a little bit too, because then it lets it which things run in which order. Whereas, like, you can imagine distributed computing on the framework where you do say, I'm going to run subtraction over the entire list, but it must run in this order, it's not going to be as efficient. So what I how do we do IO and Spark? What if we just write a row to a database and every single map that we do over the list? Is it going to work? Maybe. That's what you mean by work. If you map over your data and bring back your database, it's going to work and test it. It's going to look like it worked on your test data set and your kind of local machine. And then your database administrators are going to have a fit because you just DDoSed your database. So you had 100 machine smart cluster and had every single machine writing at full capacity back to your database. One of my friends, it was at a company that actually had someone do that, and it was not a good day for anyone because they had, I think, a 200 node maybe cluster at that point, and they ran a job on the full cluster right back to the database. And they did take it down, and it was difficult to ignore. So don't do that. Another thing you can do that's kind of similar, but is easier to view accidentally, it's a little bit more insidious, is, like, for example, reading in a configuration file. So like if you have a configuration file on the server that you pull down, if you forget to cache it, you're going to just hit your configuration server over and over during your job. And sometimes you will hit it, sometimes you won't, and it's going to basically DDoS your configuration server also. So the point is, if you have anything you want to input to your job, you should pass it in explicitly. There are concerts out there that let you do that, but you shouldn't contribute it in your job. And if you want to pass it back out to a database, there are constructs in Spark to do that too, but you probably don't want to just go into it and just do it yourself from the mapper or producer. So try to avoid doing anything that changes the database or the side effects inside your jobs. It's probably going to have bad performance, and it's probably going to make things crash or take out your energy. So that's what I have for you. So a whirlwind tour of functional programming as told by the unit, and a little bit of instruction in Spark and big data. So does anyone have any questions?
Spoken about many clusters, and how much it operates to do the worst large number of nodes.
Yeah. So if you run a new on a single node, it's going to be less efficient than if you just did if you do it in Spark, you're going to be less efficient than if you're just doing it in something on main. So if you can put it on a single server, there might be an advantage to doing it as far as productivity goes, but it's not going to give you any efficiency gain. The efficiency gain is where you start having to scale up beyond one machine, beyond two machines. Because it tends to scale, it's only slightly sublinear, so it's pretty close to just being proportional performance to how many machines. Well, if anyone knows